Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive, everybody. Children are back in the classroom, but this year they may be learning a little bit more than reading, writing, and math.
Well, former White House writer Mary Beth Hicks says students will also be getting a lesson in political correctness. And that's one reason why American kids have fallen way behind international competition. Take a look.
Today's parents must be brave parents to protect their kids from being misled by the media, educators, and their peers. That's the warning from author and columnist Mary Beth Hicks. In her new book, Don't Let the Kids Drink the Kool-Aid, Confronting the Left's Assault on Our Families, Faith, and Freedom, she sounds the alarm on the views of the next generation. Hicks reports that frightening percentages of our children believe that socialism is better than the free market. Christianity is judgmental, America is the villain of world history, and family does not mean marriage. She says parents must work to reset their children's moral compass so they have the strong character and values needed to lead our nation into the future. If not, she says, we'll soon wake up in a very different America, a far cry from the land of the free.
Well, please welcome to 700 Club Interactive, author Mary Beth Hicks. Mary Beth, welcome.
Good morning, Gordon. How you doing?
I'm doing great. So what's the Kool-Aid? What do we need to keep our kids from drinking?
Well, I'll tell you, the best way I can explain it is to tell a story just from this week that has happened from Fort Worth, Texas. A student in his German class was engaged in a side conversation with a fellow student. And he expressed that his Christian beliefs taught him that homosexuality was wrong. This was in a German class, and so it wasn't really about Germany or German speaking. But the teacher overheard his comment to his friend and sent him to the principal's office. He was disciplined in some way for simply expressing his opinion that his Christian beliefs taught him that homosexuality was wrong. So that's the Kool-Aid, and it's happening all over.
Well, he was suspended. It's now become sort of a legal case. The school district is backing way off of it. And it looks like you used to hear a lot of talk about intellectual freedom and how we needed to have free debate, and specifically schools needed to be sort of protected spaces where we could do that. But it looks like our intellectual freedom has sort of, it's dying out. If we've got to be politically correct in everything, and every child has to sort of mimic back the politically correct speech, isn't that the thing that's changing us?
Completely. And our children are learning that there are only a few places where you can express your opinions, but that in the schools, and certainly it's being reinforced in their media and in pop culture, there's only one right way to think, and it's the way that the left is teaching our children. So, for example, in the Kool-Aid book, I talk about a story out of North Georgia, and now 2 years ago, where the cheerleader squad wanted to hold the posters that the football team ran through, had Bible verses on them about being strong and being courageous. They were told they couldn't do that anymore. So instead, they were able to post their posters in something that the district called a free speech zone.
Yeah.
Which, you know, that rumbling sound is the sound of our founding fathers turning over in their graves. You know, suffice to say, we're supposed to live in a free speech zone through the entire country. But our children are learning that if they don't speak in the way that the left, I would argue the radical left, is training them up to believe, then they will be reprimanded, they'll be silenced, and there'll be consequences.
How do we keep our kids from, I guess even ourselves, from drinking the Kool-Aid? It seems to be everywhere now. Whether you look at media, or you look at government, or you look at schools, this kind of newspeak is really taking over and is becoming part of the culture.
My goal in this book was to really arm parents, grandparents, coaches, teachers, pastors, others with a sense of what it's like to be a child in this United States, to grow up knowing that there are certain things you're being told you have to spit back as fact, as belief, as politically correct. And so our kids need to have our advocacy, but we can't do it for them if we don't even know what they're being told and what they're being confronted with. So I think that really we need to arm ourselves with more knowledge, more engagement as adults, so we can understand what it's like, as I said, to be a child growing up in America in 2011. And then once we do that, we need to help our kids know that they are free to have their opinions, to express them, and they don't leave their free speech right at the schoolhouse door. And they really, they can be armed to become much greater advocates for themselves if they know what to look for. And then the third thing I would really argue is that we need to become much more media literate as adults. We're allowing too much into our homes and thus into the hearts and minds of our children because we're not aware enough of what they're watching and listening to and seeing. And so we're letting a lot of bad stuff in that we should be filtering out.
And something that just happened yesterday on Southwest Airlines, where you have a couple, according to other passengers, it was excessive, according to the one who claims she was kicked off the plane. I don't know how you get kicked off a plane when it's landed at your destination, but that she's saying, I was kicked off the plane for having a kiss with my partner on the plane. And now Southwest is in a bit of a public relations nightmare where they're being viewed as somehow anti-gay for saying, please don't do excessive on our plane. It's not appropriate. It's not a place to do that. Have we gotten to the point where literally as a culture, we can't say no to anything anymore?
Oh, yeah, I think so. I think that's a big issue is that people are afraid to, we don't have what would be considered social mores anymore, Gordon. We don't have things that we simply say, well, you would never do that, or you'd never say that. You would never express yourself with public displays of affection in that way. And so now we sort of we've gotten confused with the idea of liberty and license. People believe that they have license to do anything and whoever they offend, they don't care. And if you try and incorporate any kind of social moray or social behavioral expectations, then you're being a bigot in some sense. And so, you know, it's really, we've lost a lot of manners, a lot of etiquette. We're not teaching that to our children. And so people who still have it and who express it and would like it to be respected are often perceived as the bad guy. And it sounds like that's another case where that's has happened.
Have we lost the culture war? I mean, has it gotten to the level where you can't really stand for anything without being perceived as bigoted?
I hate to say it. We have lost the culture war, Gordon. We've lost. And it's not a war that we can't re-engage. In fact, we must. That's the whole purpose of my writing this book. If I thought it was over and done with, I wouldn't have spent 2 years of my life working on this. Mm-hmm. And more importantly, you know, I have children, and I want them to inherit an America that has a place for their religious freedom, for their expression, and for their conservative ideas. And those are valuable. And in fact, oddly enough, survey after survey tells us that most Americans consider themselves fairly conservative or at least moderate and very traditional in their ideas and beliefs. And yet we are sort of allowing ourselves to be run over by a fringe element of culture that is all about shocking us and causing us to be uncomfortable. And so that we're marginalized to the extent that we can't really feel we have a right to engage in our own culture the way everybody else does. So, you know, it's time that we do a little bit of asserting ourselves as traditionalists, as more conservative family people, and say, you know, this is not the America we want our kids to inherit. And so we have to do more to assure that they have a nation that reflects the values that we were founded on.
Well, I keep comforting myself with the thought that Christianity arose in the first century in the Roman Empire. And there was definitely a culture there that was wide open. And how did Christianity succeed in the middle of all of that? And you know, the flip side of that is, can America get worse from where it is now? The answer is, if you look at history and what the Romans were doing, yeah, you sure can. But at the same time, you can get hope that, you know, if we go back to what the Christians were doing in the first century, we can still come back. What would you advise parents to do today? It's, on some levels, should we retreat to the mountain enclave and try to shut off the internet and all television and just teach them the classics? What should we do?
Yeah, you're describing what my daughter, my 13-year-old, calls Amish lockdown. And she's hopeful I don't go for that. I think if we can practice a little more intelligent consumption of media, certainly we can enjoy many wonderful things that are out there without insulting our intelligence and our morals with much of what is meant to shock us. The first thing I would argue, though, is we need to be shocked, Gordon. I mean, I think we're losing our ability to be shocked. And, you know, we're not as indignant as we ought to be. We're not as righteously indignant about what we see in the culture. And we need to take a stand and say, this is not good enough for our family. This is not good enough for our children. And we're going to make sure that we really set some standards in our homes that really reflect the values that we want our children to have instilled in their hearts. And when we do that a little more consistently, I think that we'll see some improvement in our own communities. And then we start to spread out. We have the, you know, we're the home where we don't watch a certain show or we don't allow certain kinds of language. And then next thing you know, we're spreading that kind of good attitude among our friends and neighbors. And I think that people take courage from one another. We know this as Christians and we know it as believers. We certainly can see it politically as well in some of the movement that is the grassroots efforts to kind of recapture a traditional America. So I think that more of that is where it's at. And we need to teach our kids that they're not powerless to recapture the country for themselves and their generation.
All right. Well, Mary Beth's book, Don't Let the Kids Drink the Kool-Aid. It's available at bookstores nationwide and also online. Mary Beth, thanks again.
Thanks for being here. Great to see you.
Good to see you. Terry, over to you.
Well, when we come back, European officials are snatching children from their parents. Find out why these abductions are causing families to flee their very homes after this.
Suddenly, I started feeling horrible. I had pain all over my body. I felt completely drained, and I just knew something must be going on.
Jane Garcia Valseca has stage 4 breast cancer that has spread to her bones.
We were completely devastated. There was this little part deep down inside of me that makes me a woman, that makes me a mother, that said, get up. This is not over. I just couldn't give up. I knew there had to be answers. I started compiling my own data, and I set out to find a healing team. And we found Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
I met with Dr. Willis the very first day, and he sat down and talked to me about the options. And so I thought, wow, options, I like that.
There's no alternative to superb, up-to-date clinical care with integration of complementary techniques.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
I wanted to treat my mind, my body, my emotions, my nutrition, not just the cancer. This is patient-centered care. They make you feel that.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole-person compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
I feel like there's not anything that we can't go through now. I don't know how we would have landed on our feet had it not been for going to CTCA. We have so much to be thankful for.
Call or go to cancercenter.com today to learn more about our unique approach to state-of-the-art cancer care. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
As many as 2 million American children are homeschooled. But if parents in some European countries try to teach their own children, the government can actually take their kids away from them. Dale Hurd has this shocking report.
In Sweden, police burst onto a plane and snatched 7-year-old Dominic Johansson from his parents as they were about to leave the country. Earlier, they had told school officials they were going to homeschool Dominic, and officials opened an investigation. In Germany, home video of the government's abduction of 7-year-old Dan Schultz. As police grab him, you can hear him scream in German that he doesn't want to leave his home. His mother, Heidi, is pleading with police. Dan was kept out of school because of fears that Heidi's estranged husband might kidnap him. Dan had been homeschooled and began attending a private Christian school one day before this raid. This is typically how homeschooled children are taken in Germany, in police raids. Germany's well-documented trampling of parents' rights and homeschoolers caused the Wunderlich family to flee for France in hopes of finally being free to educate their children themselves. Except a few weeks ago, French police raided their home, taking custody of the Wunderlichs' four kids. Cases like these, repeated over and over in Europe, are why some say Europe has declared war not just on homeschoolers, but on parents' rights. Sweden is about to make homeschooling illegal in most cases, and even Britain is looking to clamp down on homeschooling. But Germany is by far the most repressive state in Europe toward homeschooling. There may be as few as 300 homeschooling families left in Germany. The rest have fled. Some say when it comes to homeschooling, the old wall around communist East Germany has simply moved west. German homeschoolers are watched by their neighbors. They're turned in. They're questioned, investigated, fined, jailed, until they either quit or flee the country. One family that refuses to give up is the Schmidts in the Bavarian town of Oettingen near Augsburg. The government first tried financial pressure against them, more than $20,000 in fines, and is now trying to take custody of their youngest son, Aaron. The Schmidts are a model family by any standard. Their oldest son, Joshua, was homeschooled and has done well on his national exams. The father, Hans, works with the handicapped, teaching them skills. The mother, Petra, is a tutor of other children and is a school crossing guard entrusted by the state with the lives of other parents' children. But German officials ignore not only that, they ignore their own laws that uphold parental rights. Joel Thornton of the International Human Rights Group is one of the lawyers representing the Schmidts.
Their constitution, their state constitution, the federal constitution, the European Convention on Human Rights, all specifically and explicitly give parents the right to control the education of their children, particularly because of religious belief.
And Christian families like the Schmidts don't want their kids in German state schools, where very young children may be taught occult practices and explicit sex education.
A lot of things that are going on in the second, third, fourth grades are things that I'm not comfortable sitting here telling you go on. There are homework assignments where children come home and are asked to interact with their parents about their sexual relationship in the fourth grade.
The German government treats homeschoolers like common criminals. The Schmidts have had their bank accounts frozen and been threatened with a lien on their home and jail. But Petra is not giving up.
Just ask the children. They know I'm a fighter, and a mother fights for her children. With every new attack, I feel in my heart, Lord Jesus, we're going to keep pressing on.
The more difficulties that have arisen through this situation, we realized more and more how God was standing behind us, supporting us. And God always, at the last moment and the end, did exactly the right thing for us. And I want to give him the glory for that.
Son Aaron wonders why the state won't just leave them alone.
I ask myself, why? Why does this all have to be? Why can't they accept homeschooling?
The Schmidt's German lawyer, Gabriela Eckermann, says the reason is political correctness. The trampling of parents' rights and the abductions of children from good families in Europe have some in this country worried that America needs a parents' rights amendment to the Constitution. Critics say it has little chance of passage. The Schmidts remain in the midst of a long court fight. Good news for the Wunderlich family, a French court has returned the children to their parents. But Dominic Johansson in Sweden remains in state custody, as does Dan Schultz in Germany. His mother, Heidi, says she prays every day for the return of her son. Dale Hurd, CBN News, in Munich, Germany.
Really astonishing and should be very troubling to all of us. I think what you spoke to Mary Beth about earlier on the program is something that, if not addressed at the stage where it's addressable, can progress to something like this, the loss of rights. I mean, we better stand up while we have each other and the opportunity and the freedom to do that.
Well, it's been the goal for centuries that if you can control what children learn and how they're raised, if you can control that, then you can profoundly influence that society to adopt your worldview. When you look at how in America political correctness has literally taken over the entire educational system, and what used to be trumpeted from the standpoint of intellectual freedom to first allow it in and allow it to be taught, and now has become, this is the dogma of the age, and this is the way we're going to go, and your other intellectual freedom to think the way you want to think is now gone. You must allow your children to be taught by us so that they will think our way. This is the way that you literally have thought control, mind control, all the horrors that George Orwell wrote about, and we're seeing it rampant now in Europe. Will that come to the United States? I do think the legislatures who are wise to protect homeschoolers, and those protections are in place on a state-by-state basis. But could we see something come from the federal government? Maybe. Do we need a parental amendment to the Bill of Rights? Maybe. Will it ever get passed? Probably not. Well, coming up, we've received your inbox questions. Arlene writes, they are enforcing drug testing on all the students in my son's high school this year. Is this crossing our rights as parents? I'll answer that and more when we come back.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Well, after his parents both died, the teenager in our next story almost never smiled. He just couldn't get past his grief until a message at summer camp brought him hope and healing.
13-year-old Jinjin lives with his grandparents because his parents died when he was young. He never really got over the loss.
I miss them a lot.
It's affected Jinjin's personality and outlook on life.
Some people in the village look down on me because I'm an orphan, so I spend a lot of time by myself.
He's even shy around his grandma and grandpa.
I just don't feel like they really understand me.
Jinjin's future wasn't looking too promising until he was invited to a summer camp for children set up by CBN. 66 children from Jinjin's village attended.
It was the happiest time of my life.
On the last day of the camp, Jinjin heard something he'd never heard before.
I learned that God loves me, and I decided to accept Jesus as my Savior and Lord. Now, I trust God.
It was a summer that changed Jinjin's life forever.
I felt loved at the CBN summer camp. Now, I want to share this love with others.
Thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of that. You're part of CBN International, bringing help to people in China, India, Indonesia, Philippines, Africa, Latin America. You're part of all of it when you join the 700 Club. We're a lot more than just a TV show. We want to reach the world. We want to reach people with love and compassion. We want to help those in need. If that's you, we're asking now to join with us to say, yes, I want to become a member of the 700 Club. How much is it? It's just $20 a month, 65 cents a day. So if you want to join, call us right now. The number's toll free, 888-777-1999, or you can log on to CBN.com. When you call, we ask you to join via Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving. The bank does all the work. There's no checks to write, nothing to mail in. We save so much in the processing, we can send as our gift back to you monthly teaching CDs called Power for Life. So if you'd like those, ask for Pledge Express when you call. All right, it's time for inbox questions.
It is. We've received your inbox questions, and Arlene writes this one. What are your feelings about random high school drug testing? My 10th grade son is a good teenager, and I feel like this is crossing our rights as parents. This year will be the first year they've done this. What do you think?
Arlene, I do think it's crossing a line, and I think it's a terrible line to cross. I think it invades the rights of parents. I think it invades the rights of privacy of the children involved. At the same time, I can understand it from the school standpoint, and particularly from athletic association standpoints, that amazing to me, but steroid abuse has now invaded the high schools. And kids, in an effort to try to be the superstar on the team or some kind of dream that eventually they'll go pro, are saying, well, if the pro athletes are doing it, then I need to do it. And without this kind of testing, we're not going to be able to stop it. If high school students have it in their head that, you know, if the great superstar on my pro team is taking steroids and it's helping him, then how much is it going to help me in high school? And they don't understand the ramifications and the long-term health effects. So because of the plague, if you will, of what's going on in professional sports has now invaded college sports and now high school sports, I understand while, you know, it's now a ticket to compete that you've got to have a random drug test. And the goal here is to stop young kids from getting into things they've got no business experimenting with and trying to build muscle mass with these various cocktails, if you will, of drugs that can really hurt them. So, yes, we've crossed the line. Yes, it invades rights of privacy. Yes, it interferes with your rights as a parent. But at the same time, because kids are doing it and the evidence is there that they're doing it, we've got to find an effective way to make it stop. Well, our next question comes in from Carolyn. This one's for Terry. This is going to sound really unimportant compared to major medical prayer requests, but I just started high school and I don't have classes with any of my friends, and it makes me very nervous. I'm really quiet and shy. How can I push past this barrier so I can make new friends?
Well, that doesn't sound unimportant to me at all, Carolyn. I think that lots of people experience what you're feeling, even adults, you know, that are put in awkward situations. You know, one of the things that someone shared with me a long time ago, and it has really, really helped me, when we feel awkward in places or circumstances like that, it's usually because our focus is on ourselves and the discomfort that we're feeling, our shyness, whatever it might be. But if you can think about the people who are around you, just listen to the conversations that are going on, care about what they're saying, and let the conversation be about them. You know, people love to talk about themselves, and in today's world, we're all kind of disconnected from each other. So I think if you put the other person first and you start thinking about how you might encourage them or say something that matters to them, or that you're just listening to what they have to say and find it valuable, you'll find that people will open up to you, and suddenly you'll have a whole new circle of friends. I also think that happens to be scriptural, that we put other people before ourselves. So give it a shot, see how it works.
All right, time to take some calls. Here's Jerry from Arkansas. Hi, Jerry.
Hi.
How can we pray for you?
For my son. He's locked up. He's been locked up ever since the 7th of this month, and ever since he's been in there, he's been trying to kill himself. They have him in, like, on suicide watch, and I'm just keeping him in prayer and believing God for a miracle in his life.
All right, Jerry. What's his name? Anthony. All right. Lord, we just lift Anthony to you, and we just break off of him any word that his life is over, and we speak hope and peace to him. And Lord, I just ask that you would come to him in his cell. I ask that messengers after your own heart would come to visit him in his time of need and speak words of encouragement and comfort over him. Let him know that no matter what mistake he's made, you're able to see him through. You're able to redeem. You're able to restore. You're even able to set free. And so, Lord, we just ask that that peace would come to him, that freedom would come to him in the middle of a cell, that he would know you.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Thanks for calling, Jerry.
Thank you.
All right. That's all the time we have. We leave you this word from Psalm 32. I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you and watch over you.